You might find yourself in a situation similar to this. Someone you care about feels short of breath. If they've just run a mile, give them a minute and everything should be fine. If there's no immediately apparent reason, you might consider supplemental oxygen. Depending on many factors, which vary wildly under different conditions, doctors, hospitals, or prescriptions may not be readily available. So in the interim, if you have some industrial oxygen on hand, here's a system that I came up with that uses the available oxygen in your oxyacetylene welding outfit to at least experiment. Of course, if you have access to a pulse oximeter, you should measure to see if their blood saturation is low. If their oxygen concentration measures normal, then don't expect anything to change when you supply the supplemental. But if it measures below normal, then set up the system and see if after some time has gone by, it returns to a normal level. In the absence of a pulse oximeter, you'll just have to examine them and see if the symptoms diminish. It's very subjective, but may be all you have at the time. It is worth the time to set this up in advance of any anticipated need and make sure it works and makes sense. You can probably find any parts you don't already have available on Amazon. For example, you can get a 5-pack of cannula and 25 feet of tubing at Walmart for $20. There are a few things to think over before you get started. The first that occurred to me was how to measure flow. Using this graph of CFM versus nozzle size, I've plotted several traces at different PSI that will at least get you in the ballpark. For example, in my case, I run the line pressure just about as low as the regulator will go. With the needle sitting almost on zero, I can still hear the flow, so I guess that I'm running about 10 PSI. Since my nozzle size is about 50 thousandths, or just over 3/64, which I found by measuring a tip cleaner, if I enter the chart just above 3/64 and go up to the 1 PSI line, then across to the cubic inches per minute, or the other way to the liters per minute, I see that the flow will be about 200 cubic inches per minute, or close to 4 liters per minute, which is above my target flow of 2 liters per minute. I have to be careful to remain below 10 liters per minute to avoid oxygen toxicity. You can probably see that I would need less than 1 PSI to get to my target flow. On the patient end, I've installed a flow meter for fine adjustment to dial in the desired flow. I added a filter and a bubbler to the system just in case. I don't want any tiny debris to get through the tubing, and in the dry winter conditions around here, a little moisture never hurts. Another thing to think about is how much oxygen you have on hand and how long it will last. My welding cylinder is a T size, and as far as I can figure, it will hold about 5,000 liter when filled to 2,000 PSI. This should yield about 40 hours of oxygen if the rate of flow is 2 liters per minute. 40 hours sounds like a lot, but if you use it 24 hours a day, it's just less than 2 days, making cost a consideration. Some online literature says that this bottle can be filled to 8,500 liters, but even with a fill of 3,000 PSI, I can only come up with just over 7,000. I'm guessing at the wall thickness of the cylinder when I calculate the volume. The cylinder weighs about 135 pounds, so wrestling it into and out of the pickup to transport it for a fill is a complication. Also, while it is disconnected to go and get exchanged, the patient is without the supplement. You begin to see why people have their oxygen delivered by a generator or a concentrator or have several bottles on hand. We regularly have one blizzard a year here that has us shut in for a couple of days, which might make getting a cylinder filled difficult.